this a historian, a Greek historian, who was trying to capture why the wars that went on between the Persians and the Greeks, what happened. He writes about the gods of Egypt and Persia. He writes in his book, "I am not anxious to set forth, save only the matter of the gods' names. For I think that all men know equally about the gods. We have read Zeus and Jupiter, and they're the same gods. And we have read the different gods of Egypt and the different gods of Greece and the different gods of Persia, and they're actually all the same gods, usually." That's what he's referring to here. He said, look, they're all the same, so I'll just include the names, but that's about it, because we already know about them. "When I do mention the gods, it will be because my history forces me to do so." The idea was this. There's a lot of mythology, a lot of hogwash, we would call it. He recognized that, and he said, look, I don't really want to talk about it, but I will if I have to. Now, my question is this. If a historian were to write about my life, would he be forced, because of my life, to write about God? I should hope so. Herodotus, who wrote about 450 BC, writes about 100 years, actually a little less, than Daniel in Persia lived. Herodotus will write his first section of his book is about Cyrus, under whom a part of his life Daniel lived. So we'll be reading from Daniel chapter 9 today, and you'll be in a good position for the sermon if you turn there. We have visitors, and we are grateful for your presence. If we say or do something that you expect, or don't say or do something that you expect, please talk to us about it. We are trying to serve God. We believe in His Bible. We believe it's from God. And we believe that we will answer to God someday, and that's what we're trying to prepare for. That you're here shows you're interested in spiritual things, and you are to be commended for that. Last, please turn off or down or whatever, silence your distraction devices so that we can serve God the way we ought to. The first thing I want to talk about real quick is in Daniel 9, the next section. So we read from the first three verses 2 weeks ago. And now we're going to get into actually his prayer. This is the first part was an introduction to his prayer. This is his prayer. His prayer breaks down into two major parts, verses 4 through 14, the confession, and then verses 15 through 19, the supplication, the request. Big word meaning request. He's going to ask God for something. Now, even further, this breaks down. The first part breaks down into 1a, which is verses 4 through 6, the sin, and then 1b, which is 7 through 14, the resulting situation. So it's either two parts, one of them has two subparts, or we're going to look at three parts really today. So we'll begin reading Daniel 9, verse 1. "In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of Median descent, who was made king over the kingdom of the Chaldeans." Another word for Babylon, we're talking 539, 538 BC. And this is well documented in what we call secular history also. "In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, observed in the books the number of the years which was revealed as the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet for completion of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. So I gave my attention to the Lord God to seek him by prayer and supplications with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes." Okay, the situation, the backdrop is this. God chose Israel, Mount Sinai, gave the Ten Commandments and said, I love everybody in the world. I'm the God of everybody, but I'm choosing you to be a special nation for me. You could think of it as ambassadors. I choose you, Israel, to be my ambassadors. Now, the conditions of the covenant were laid out in what John Edward wrote, read part of it. If you obey me, it's going to go great for you. If you disobey me, it's going to be bad. And you'll notice that most of what John Edward wrote, read was bad, we would say. I mean, God lays it on and lays it on because he wants them to get the point. If you disobey me, it's going to be really, really bad. Well, they disobeyed some hundreds and hundreds of years later. And so he takes them like he said he would. He takes them out of the promised land, out of Palestine, we would say, brings them over to Assyria over here for you guys. And further into Babylon. And he puts them there. And he says, look, you're going to be there for 70 years. This is a big spanking. You can, if you just choose to obey me, everything will go well. If you don't, you're going to get a big spanking. They are in the big spanking. Daniel reads Jeremiah, a prophet that was back in Jerusalem, who wrote, you're going to be there for 70 years. Well, we did the math last week. It's the end of the 70 years. It's somewhere around year 68 or 69. Daniel reads and says, hey, it's 70 years. And God said, we're going to go back, so I'm going to pray to him. That's the situation. We're basically caught up. Verse 3, so I gave my attention to the Lord to seek him by prayer and supplications with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. And this means he's serious. This reflects his heart. You know, we have weird mourning rituals ourselves. We wear black when somebody has died. Well, when this person is showing to his God that he is in mourning about their situation, he puts ashes on their, they sprinkle it on their head, and he wears this rough clothing. All an outward sign of an inward heart. Verse 4, I prayed to the Lord my God. Remember that for later. The Lord my God. And confessed and said, alas. And we're going to start there. This word is an interjection. It would be like wow, except it's somewhat negative. It's used 13 times in the Old Testament, every single one of them in a prayer to God. It talks about impact. Now you notice verse 3 was somewhat of a process. Fasting. That's not just I read and then I prayed. There's a process going on, and throughout this entire time, Daniel is impacted by what he read and his situation. For example, if somebody dies, we're not going to get over that very quickly. Our loved one dies. We're not going to get over it like that. We are going to be impacted. So we begin with its impact. Then he says, he prayed to the Lord my God, confessed and said, alas, O Lord, great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant and loving kindness for those who love him and keep his commandments. Look at this. God first, God's greatness first. That's the prayer. O Lord. And then he goes right into what a great God this God is that he's praying to. You might remember the Lord's Prayer, we call it Matthew chapter 6. Our Father who is in heaven, please give us our daily bread and forgive us. No. It actually goes, our Father, this is Jesus praying, our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name, which means apart, separated, honored be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be. The first part of the prayer is God, and then me. The same thing here. If I were to die one sentence in to a prayer, may it have been words of praise that were said. In fact, Jonathan did that. He started it and he went on. He waxed eloquently about how great our God is. He goes on. Verse 4. Here comes the confession. Verse 4. We have sinned. Now, I'm not going to do this through the whole prayer, but we're going to look at some of these words. Sinned is to miss the mark. It's actually an archery term. You draw back your bow, you let the arrow fly, and it misses the mark. Whoops, I made a mistake. To make a false step, erring from the right. You'll notice as we go through these that this is, if you will, more innocent of the others. There's nothing innocent about sinning against God. Don't get me wrong. But this, it'll get more pronounced as we go. We have committed iniquity. To be perverse, we understand that word a little bit. Actually, the word means to bend, to curve, to twist, or distort. That's the root idea behind it. In Psalm 38, verse 6, the Lord, don't turn there unless you want to, the Lord, David, has not confessed his sin to the Lord. And God is pressing down on his conscience. And David feels the weight. He's got a skeleton in his closet, and he can't get rid of it. And in it he says, I am bent over and greatly bowed down. I'm bent over. You see the shape. That's literally what's going on there. Esther 1:16, Queen Vashti, when she rejects the king's request, he says she has wronged not only the king, but every man who's married in the country. Wronged. The idea being that she was deviant. Her behavior was deviant. Look, this is what's expected. When I give you a command, you obey the command. I'm the king, right? Well, you didn't, so you have been rebellious. Saul, King Saul, when Solomon tries to help David, Saul hurls his spear at his own son, and Saul's anger burned against Jonathan, and he said to him, Saul's anger burned against Jonathan, and he said to him, you son of a perverse, rebellious woman. So this, his mother, no, it's hyperbole, but the idea is, look, she's not only rebellious, but she is perverse. This is what this person is saying. Look, we've messed up. You know, this is not innocent. Sinning is never innocent. But compared to this, this is bad. We rebelled. Or I might have missed one in there. Yeah, we acted wickedly. Violently transgressed. I mean, we didn't just sin. We violently sinned. To do wrong as a passionate rebellion against God. I want this. I want it bad. I am going to rebel against God. In Jeremiah chapter 3, Jeremiah says that, the Lord says through Jeremiah, that Israel, the northern territory, as bad, you remember how bad they were? They were so bad, they got deported first. And in Jeremiah chapter 3, God says, as bad as they were, the southern kingdom was worse. Ezekiel chapter 5, as bad as Israel was, as bad as Judah was, they were worse than even the nations around them. The nations who God in Genesis says, look, I'm kicking them out of this because they're so... You remember Romans chapter 1? That Gentile picture of depravity? This is what he's saying. This word wicked is the same word in Ezekiel chapter 5 where he says, you're worse than the nations around you. And then they rebelled. Even turning aside from your commandment and your ordinances. This is just saying, look, we did horrible, and it's emphasizing we rebelled against God. Can you imagine rebelling against God? That's what he said. We have rebelled against God. It's emphatic in its position. Notice what's going on here. He's heaping it on, and there's a climax. We sinned. We committed iniquity. We acted wickedly. We even rebelled. And it gets worse and worse and worse, and he's not done. Verse 6 says in the New American Standard, moreover, that's the idea, it's a conjunction, it's either and or then or something like that. Moreover, we did all of this and we're not done yet. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, our fathers, and all the people of the land. We all are totally guilty. Now, that is not a position of strength to be in when you're about to ask for something. It does not get what could you possibly hope for in this situation? You're before the judge for sentencing. They have video of you, audio, fingerprints, DNA, eyewitnesses, your blood, your confession, and your hand has been severed, it's still hanging on to the gun. What hope do you have? Normally, none. But who are we dealing with? You know that long list that God said, if you disobey me, you're going to go over there? That same God, we forget, is great and awesome, keeps his covenant and loving kindness for those who love him. He's forgiving and compassionate. What hope can you have? All the hope that there possibly is because of who our God is. We could talk about hope, and that would be a valid conversation. Because of who God is, we have hope. But I don't want to waste this opportunity. And that is, I want to make the most of this opportunity and say, because of who He is, think of that. Our God is great and awesome. His ways are higher than our ways. This is what Daniel is saying. This brings us to the resulting situation. Verse 7. It begins with, righteousness belongs to you. Now, other commentaries, and I am right now acting in the role of a commentary, although I'm preaching, they have the division at verse 10 and 11. It doesn't really matter. I get it here. I'll tell you why in just a second. It doesn't really matter. Righteousness belongs to you, O Lord, but to us, open shame. Open shame. Verse 8, open shame belongs to us, O Lord, to our kings, to our princes, to our fathers, because we have sinned against you. Okay. The open shame, the King James Version is the closest to what it's literally saying. There is confusion of face. Well, what does that mean? Kyle will say, shame, which reflects in the countenance. That's your face. That's what your face looks like. When you're happy, you smile. When you're sad, you do the other. That's your countenance. This shame is reflecting on their faces. Not because of disgraceful circumstances, although do not miss this in what we're about to read. Deuteronomy 28. If you sin, I'm going to send you into disgraceful circumstances. And that's where they are. Don't miss this or you'll misunderstand the whole entire scripture, this prophecy, this prayer and then the prophecy. But I'm not really going to dwell on it here. But this shame is from the consciousness of well-deserved suffering. And this is what Daniel is going to pound home right now. We deserve everything that we have got. But he begins with, righteousness belongs to you. Okay, righteousness can be one of two things, an inherent characteristic. It's only God has it in Jesus. And then he ascribes righteousness. You have always done what is right. You are righteous. And then there's the things that we do. When I go and help somebody out of the right motive, I have done a righteous action. God is right and always does what is right. Righteousness as a perfection which is manifested in his operations on the earth, or specifically in his dealings towards Israel, as it's used right here. God is righteous. He always does what is right. Notice, it's what he is doing. And that is what Daniel is going to emphasize here in this section. Righteousness belongs to you, O Lord, but to us open shame. Now, I want you to read, I read out of the New American Standard, I want you to read with me from this just so you get it. Not that this is a big deal, but why I put the break at verse 7 is because he begins with, righteousness belongs to you. Okay, God, you always do what is right. Now listen, there's going to be some repetition here. O Lord, but to us open shame, as it is this day, to the men of Judah, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and all of Israel, those who are nearby and those who are far away, in all the countries to which you have driven them. Notice, they are driven. They are in shame. It's a bad situation. Don't miss this. Because of their unfaithful deeds which they have committed against you. Open shame belongs to us, O Lord, to our kings, to our princes, our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord our God belong compassion and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him, nor have we obeyed the voice of our Lord, the Lord our God, to walk in his teachings which he set before us through his servants the prophets. Indeed, all Israel has transgressed your law and turned aside, not obeying your voice. So, this is where he's going with all this. We have done wrong. We have done wrong. We have done wrong. We're in a bad situation. We have done wrong. Now listen to what he does. So, the curse has been poured out on us. That's what John Edward read. There's the curse. Along with the oath. In other words, God says, when he says the curse, this will happen to you. When he adds an oath, he's saying, whenever God says something, it's going to happen anyway. But when he says, I mean it, I have an oath by myself, this will happen. It's only emphasizing how much it's going to happen. And then he goes, which is written in the law of Moses. And understand what he's doing here. God is right. He always does what is right. We sinned. God told us, if we sin, this is what will happen. Guess what happened? We sinned, and God always does what he says he will do. Always. This is the emphasis of this part of the prayer. Written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, for we sinned against him. Thus he confirmed his words which he had spoken. Oh, really? Oh, what a surprise. God did what he would say, said he would do. Against us and our fathers, our rulers who ruled us, to bring on us great calamity. For under the whole heaven there has not been done anything like what was done to Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, as it is written, all this calamity has come. As written, it came. That's his point. God said it, it happened. God said it, it happened. That's what God does. God is an I said it, it will happen machine. That's who God is. Yet we have not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our iniquity and giving attention to your truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept the calamity in store. It means he was looking at it. I was looking at it. This is the bad you were doing. This is what I said I would do. I'm looking at the two and I got to do it. That's God's perspective, if you will. And brought it on us. For the Lord our God is righteous with respect to all. He always does what he says he will do. This is the very definition of faithfulness. This is it. I said it. I did it. Every single time. Daniel understands this. Daniel's appeal is in this. Isaiah 55. A passage we know so well. As the rain and the snow come down from the heaven and do not return there without watering the earth and making it bear fruit and sprout and furnishing the seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be, which goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. All right. So we have a forecast. For many years, I thought to myself, what is a forecast? There are several different explanations. Here is one of them. When you hear the idea of 65% chance of rain, what's that based on? Well, it's a comparison of all the other days with similar conditions. The dew point is at this number, and the humidity is at this number, and all the wind's blowing from the southeast, and all these, you add all these different conditions together. Of all the other days with similar conditions, it has rained on 65% of those days. When all these other days, there were 100% of days that have these conditions, 65% of them it rained. Why didn't it rain the other times? Don't know. And that's our uncertainty. But there is no uncertainty with God. I'll tell you this. If it rains, the ground will be watered. That's what he's saying. And just like that, folks, my word, God says, will do what I send it for. And just like that, God will always do what he said he will do. Every single time, that's what's going to happen. You can, as we say, take that to the bank. So, with that principle in mind, we have sinned. We got what we deserved, and God did exactly what he said he would do. Verse 15. And now, here comes the supplication, the petition, the request for God. O Lord God, who have brought your people out of Egypt with a mighty hand and have made a name for yourself as it is this day. Stop here. He brought them out of Egypt. Okay, so Israel went down into Egypt. They became slaves. And then God came and rescued them out of that. You remember that story. It's called the Exodus, right? Go and read it. have your faith built up. With a mighty hand, yeah, Egypt was the most powerful country there ever had been on the earth, and God, with his little puny little nation of slaves, had them walk out with all of Egypt's riches. Well, that's one way to demonstrate that you're strong. But there's something else going on here. He made a name for himself. Yeah, that he's strong. But let's go to the story and figure out what the name is. Exodus chapter 3. God calls Moses. Pretty sure everybody in here has heard of Moses before. Moses, he says, I'm going to send you back. Israel is in Egypt. Moses, I'm going to deliver Israel from Egypt with you. This is the story of the burning bush, this conversation. Jonathan had an excellent lesson from it a few weeks ago. Exodus 3:13, Moses said to God, Behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, What is his name? What shall I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am, or something, your version will say something like that. The idea is, it's the verb to be, and it's where we get the four letters, J-H, W-H, or Y-H, W-H, Jehovah. He says, I am Jehovah, which means to be. Okay. Thus you shall say to them, I am, has sent me to you. God furthermore said to Moses, Thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is his name, my name forever. It is my memorial name to all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has appeared to me, saying, I am now indeed concerned about you and what has been done to you in Egypt. And so I said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of Canaan. I am God. I will bring you out. Okay, Moses goes back. He talks to the elders. They say, yeah, this is great. Goes in and talks to Pharaoh. Pharaoh, let my people go. Pharaoh says, who is God? Who is this Lord you talk of? Get back to work. Your work is going to be harder now. You have to get your own straw, and you still have to make the same amount of bricks. And they say, we can't do that. He says, you're being lazy. Verse 19, chapter 5, verse 19, the foreman of the sons of Israel saw that they were in trouble because they were told, you must not reduce your daily amount of bricks. When they left Pharaoh's presence, they met Moses and Aaron as they were going in to talk to Pharaoh, and they said to Moses and Aaron, May the Lord look upon you and judge you, for you have made us odious in Pharaoh's sight and in the sight of his servants to put a sword in their hands to kill us. Look, it's all because of you. We're worse off now than we were before. Moses returned to the Lord and said, Oh Lord, why have you brought harm on this people? Why did you ever send me? Ever since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done harm to this people, and you have not delivered your people at all. Oops. But this was a setup. Oops on Moses' part, but God knew what was going to happen. I'm doing all this, so I get to show you who I am. Who am I? Not only am I mighty, but listen, the Lord said to Moses, Now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. For under compulsion he will let them go, and under compulsion he will drive them out of his hand. God further spoke to Moses and said to him, I am the Lord. It starts and ends, and it's all through the middle of this. I am the Lord. I don't mean to make silly of this, but picture God. I am the Lord. I am the Lord. And I appeared to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob as God Almighty, but by my name Lord I did not make myself known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan and the land which they have sojourned. Furthermore, I have heard the groanings of the sons of Israel because of the Egyptians are holding them in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. So say therefore to the sons of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will deliver you from their bondage, and I will also redeem you with an outstretched arm and great judgments. Then I will take you for my people, and I will be your God, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the burdens of Egypt, and I will bring you to the land which I swore to give Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and I will give it to you for a possession. I am the Lord. Daniel. That's what he referred to. You made a name for yourself. What was it? Yeah, you can beat up any god because there is no god, and you're stronger than any nation. Yes, that is in there. But it is also, when I say something, it will happen. I keep my word. That's his name that he developed for himself. Which means Daniel is still making the same point he had just been making. He's not done yet. O Lord, verse 16, in accordance with all your righteous acts. Again, why does Daniel pound so much home that, God, you always do what you say? You know why? Because Daniel can't say, we're worth saving. He's got to make the petition, look, we want to go home. Now, how do I get God? How do I convince God to send us home? Look at yourself and you say, and then there's confusion of face. I'm a sinner. Okay, let's go on to the next thing. God, send me home. I'm a sinner. That's not going to work. Ah, here's one. God always does what he said he would do. And I just read Jeremiah, and it's been 70 years, and he said, I will send you home after 70 years. Let now, verse 16, here comes the petition. In accordance with all your righteous acts, let now, number one, your anger and your wrath turn away from your holy city, Jerusalem, and your holy mountain. For because of our sins and our iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people have become a reproach to all around us. So now, O God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his supplications. And for your sake, O Lord, let your face shine on your desolate sanctuary. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city which is called by your name. For we are not presenting our supplications before you on account of any merits of our own, but on account of your great compassion. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action for your own sake. Oh my God, do not delay, because your city and your people are called by your name. Do you get the intensity of this? In verse 21, it'll say in the New American Standard and some others that this angel comes to him in his extreme weariness. Other versions will say the angel came swiftly. The extreme weariness is what's literal. Now, does it apply to Daniel praying or the angel coming? If it's the angel coming, it's just emphasizing, it's an idiom to say he came quickly. But I take it that the New American Standard got it right on this one, because after all the other prayers and all the other visions has in the book of Daniel, what is he doing? Sweating in his weariness. I'm taking it, it's the same thing here. It doesn't really matter. The intensity. Lord, 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 look, see, 11 times, send us back. And notice again the appeal. You said, God, I just read it in the book of Jeremiah, after 70 years you'll send us back. If you don't send us back, your name will suffer. Please send us home. Some thoughts. Of all the books Daniel must have read. You remember who Daniel was. Daniel was a bigwig in the nation. And the first part of Daniel is he goes and gets an education in Babylon. And I say books because they're not books, they're scrolls. You get the point. Of all the books that he must have read, I assume he had some continuing education because of his job. I might be wrong in that. But of all the books that he read, we hear of only two. Moses and Jeremiah. And from this we understand what books mattered to Daniel. You hear about the things that people prioritize. This is the book. Remember Daniel in the lion's den? You remember that story? Daniel, pray to the king. Daniel says no. Daniel, lion's den, Daniel says no. This is the book that Daniel will say, I'll die for it. This is the book that causes him to pray like he prayed. I wonder, do we scour the book to see what it says about our time? That's what he was doing. Reading Jeremiah, he says, whoa. Now, I'm not saying that we're looking for prophecy. You know, what does it say about 2017? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying, what does it say about how to defend ourselves from sin? Because we are alive and Satan is out there. How to overcome this personal character flaw? How to avoid hell? Right? Look, it's bad. The word in verse 11, the curse has been poured out on us. This is the word for the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Yeah, picture that. That's the same. That's what he's trying to emphasize. Look, it's horrible. Hell is worse than they were at. Can we avoid hell? Now, thoughts about prayer. Actually, this point isn't about prayer, but it is my prayer that we, myself and everybody in here, takes this seriously. Another point. Sometimes I want more words to give to God in my prayer. I want more. I wish I had a bigger vocabulary. I wish I could say it eloquently. I wish I could say it just more. Because God, he's a little bit beyond our vocabulary. I wish I could say more. There was a song in the 70s. If I had words to make a day for you, I'd sing you a morning golden and true. I would make this day last for all time and then fill the night deep in moonshine. I love those lyrics. If I had words. It's beautiful. The funny thing is, this is kind of an odd mixture because the author realizes that even though it's beautiful, it's inadequate. Sometimes when I pray, I wish it were more often. Sometimes when I pray, I wish I had words to express what wants to burst out of me. It's God. Ethan has it right. But did you notice the words he used? Great and awesome God. It's pretty simple. I mean, this is Daniel, pretty good guy, knows how to pray. And what does he say? Great and awesome God. Okay, I've said those words before, and that's pretty much what I'm limited to. Oh, but he does say compassionate and forgiving. Do you know what that is to God? That's what we would say, music to my ears. He is a God of compassion. That's what he loves. I want this great word. All I have to do is recognize who he is. And he says, you got it. Tell me more. Tell me more. Tell me more. Repetition is allowed. Did you notice that? I mean, Daniel said the same thing 20 times, and then he said the other thing 20 times. That wasn't it. Matthew chapter 6 tells us not to be repetitious. The question is it an absolute statement? Never repeat yourself. If it were, Jesus could not have prayed three times in the Garden of Gethsemane the same thing. It's not an absolute statement. Purpose matters. Matthew chapter 6, when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition. Ask Daniel if that was meaningless. You'd have to be from another planet to say it was. Verse 8, do not be like them, as the Gentiles do, for they suppose they will be heard for their many years. Words, because they're praying to a God that does not exist. That's why they have to say it over and over, and it never answers them. We have a real God. He hears you the first time. In fact, verse 8, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. I don't know how that works, but I know it's true. God knows what you need before you ask him. Romans chapter 8, verse 16. In Romans 8, verse 16, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, heirs also, and if heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified with him. What Paul is talking about right now is you've got to suffer if you want to be glorified. Is the suffering worth it? Here's the argument. Yes, it is. 4 points he'll make. Verse 18, I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. When Jesus comes and God and all, I have no words for it. It'll be glorious. So he'll make four arguments. They all contain the word groaning. The earth groans. The earth wants to see what's going to be. We groan. We have the first fruits, verse 23. We ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly the adoption. Verse 26, in the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. God knows what you want to say. He knows what you say before you say it. He knows what you're going to say before you say it. But he knows. Look, I wish I had a greater word than great. I wish I had an awesomer word than awesome. Well, God's got it all figured out. So use great and awesome. Be content with that. And know that God knows. The effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. Daniel was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly. A little play there. The men who move the world are men the world cannot move. The men who move the world are men the world cannot move. Daniel, if you don't pray to the king and you keep praying to God, you'll die. Daniel says, I guess I'm just going to have to die. He lives to tell another day. Gets down on his hands and knees, prays to God, and God sends these people back. What if Daniel had said, oh dear, okay, I'll pray to the king. Wouldn't that happen? Last point. Pray according to his word, guaranteed results. If you pray according to this word, God will answer it. More about this in a second. Wrong thing. Here's a water molecule. So in 2013, Dr. Payne came up and spoke in Kingston, Ontario. I went and listened. Marcy came. It was evidences why you can believe that there is a God and why there's some serious problems with the theory of evolution. Scientific problems with the theory of evolution. And he has one of these. One illustration was the angle 104.5 degrees, and he would yell it at you. Because of this angle, water has polarity, which means that it'll oppose itself, and that's why it goes up the capillary tube. Because it's pushing itself up because of that angle. It's this angle. Because of this angle, it changes the way water, or this molecule, freezes. When it freezes, it'll only freeze between 0 and 100 degrees Celsius. Well, that happens to keep the entire planet stable. On and on and on and on and on he went. He said, when you go home tonight, you're going to need to get on your hands and knees and thank God for 104.5 degrees. It was an argument from design. This is designed. This is not an accident. That is because God is an engineer and a mathematician. Math is never wrong, folks. Math is, you're wrong. Math not. Math is never wrong. Math always is consistent. 2 + 2 always returns 4. And if you pray according to his word, it will always return results, every single time. 1 John chapter 5, this is the confidence we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Here is the assignment. Go home, open your Bible, read till you find something that you know his will is his will. And then pray about it. That is how simple it is. Open it up, read till you find something that is his will, and then pray about it. Done. Now, I am not here to say that every single answer is going to be required, received right now. The answer may be not now. Not now. The answer may be not this way. Or it may be I've got something better, or it really isn't what you needed after all. Okay? It might be something else. You pray according to his will. He will hear you, and he will answer it the way he, being God, knows best. A true story. A man brought his car to the mechanic to be worked on some body damage around the door. A few days later, he picks up his car. Starts complaining to the mechanic. Scratched up, the paint is horrible. The mechanic said to him, "Excuse me, we fixed the other side. Some people know our problems better than we do. God always knows our problems better than we do." Let me close with this thought. A grandfather was going by his little granddaughter's room one night when he saw her kneeling beside her bed with head bowed and hands folded, repeating the alphabet. "What are you doing?" he asked her. She explained, "I'm saying my prayers, but I couldn't think of just what I wanted to say, so I'm saying all the letters of the alphabet, and God can put them together however he thinks best." Wow. What faith. The last point, and then we're done. I emphasized earlier, Daniel began his prayer, "O Lord, my God." If you want your prayer to be heard, you have to make him your God. There's only one way to do that. Galatians chapter 3. Verse 25, "Now that faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. You are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. For all of you who were baptized into Jesus Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free man, there is neither male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's heirs, heirs according to the promise." How do you get to belong to Christ? If you want your prayer to be heard, you better belong to him. Now, I'm not making an absolute statement. You can question me about this in a minute. But if you want your prayer to be heard, you have to belong to him. How do you belong to him? In baptism. It's the only way the New Testament says. We make an appeal to you that if you are not a child of God and you would like to be considered a child of God, this loving, compassionate, forgiving child. We have all done wrong. Every person in this audience has committed sin and admits it. The question is, have we been forgiven? If you have been baptized into Christ Jesus, then you have been forgiven. If you want that, come up, stand up here, talk to me for a minute while we stand and sing the song that's been chosen.